This is my lecture number 20, and I think this is the last lecture for this course. I will discuss with you the design of a discrete time decoupling control system using the full decoupling approach. As you remember, I presented in class four different decoupling approaches. One I call steady-state decoupling, the second one I call full decoupling, then there is decoupling using the state variable matrix vector definition of the control plant, state variable decoupling, and then I added, during this semester, I added first time, linear model following system-based decoupling approach. These decoupling techniques are basically covering most of realistic problems that you may face. So today, I will talk about the discrete time decoupling using the full decoupling approach. When it comes to the problem, you're supposed to have the transfer matrix of the control process. And to be more certain, I chose a 2x2 transfer matrix of the process. Now, the process is a continuous time process. And the process is a cross-coupled process, which implies that if I would apply signal to input number one, you would surely see response in the output number one and output number two. And the same is true if you're applying input signal to the input number two. You will see response in the output number one and output number two. Of course, this type of situation makes the control problem difficult and justifies the use of computer-based decoupling control techniques. The additional information is the design specs. The resultant system must be decoupled, and for individual channels, you will have settling time, percent overshoot, percent undershoot under some circumstances, and the time step of the discrete time controller, delta T. We will start our design task from the step number one. You know, I showed during the class various ways to establish the decoupling filter. The most straightforward approach for building the decoupling filter is to use the adjoint matrix of the transfer matrix of the controlled plant as the decoupling filter. So, if I would define the decoupling filter W as the adjoint of the transfer matrix G of S, then the product of two transfer matrices, the transfer matrix of the plant times transfer matrix of the decoupling filter, will turn into a diagonal matrix. And the diagonal elements will be the determinants of the transfer matrix G of S. And I recommend that we would compute the diagonal elements, that we will take the determinant of the transfer matrix G of S. And you may ask me, why shall we get involved with a S-domain transfer matrix? Our design is supposed to be performed in the discrete time domain. This is true. However, by defining diagonal elements, by taking these determinants of the transfer matrix in the S domain, we will be able to determine if there are right-hand side zeros, right-hand side S-domain zeros in the transfer function Q of S, and obviously this is also Q of S. Why? Because if there are no right-hand side zeros, then we can go ahead and use the output feedback controller design technique, or we can use the state variable controller design. In the case of state variable controller design, we would end up building a state observer. Now, obviously, both tasks will be performed in the discrete time domain. So I would say that the only purpose for doing this determinant is to determine if there are bad zeros in the S domain that eventually will turn into bad zeros in the Z domain. So if there are zeros in the S domain located in the left-hand side of the complex plane, it is reasonable to expect that if we would consider the same problem in the Z domain, there will be some zeros located outside the unit circle. In both cases, these bad zeros will complicate the design task. So, it doesn't make sense for me to consider situation when there is no bad zeros, because we already covered this material. I think it was part of the lecture 19 or lecture 18. This material you have. What I would like to do is to consider the situation when there are bad zeros. There are bad zeros in this determinant transfer function. And we would have to accommodate for these bad zeros by using the Diophantine equation, but this will be done in the discrete time in the Z domain. So, I will assume at this point that when this determinant is taken, I will have the denominator of S for this determinant, and the numerator could be split into two polynomials. One polynomial is the one that has good zeros, and another polynomial is the one that has bad zeros. Eventually, similar situation will be happening in the Z domain. You know, I want to make a kind of presentation, general, but not that general, and because of this, let me assume that the polynomial responsible for bad zeros is a second order polynomial, and this is how I would write it down. The next what we have to do, and this will be design step number 2, we will have to convert each of these transfer function elements of the transfer matrix from the S domain into the Z domain. And this symbol that I commonly use implies that each of these transfer function elements will be converted from the S domain into the Z domain. The conversion should utilize the zero order hold option and should be done for a particular time step of the discrete time control procedure. So this has to be done, and I would say you use a software tool to perform this type of conversions. Our next step would be to consider this matrix, This is the transfer matrix of the controlled plant, of the controlled process. But this time, it is defined in the Z domain. I am taking the determinant of this transfer matrix, and this determinant I call transfer function Q of Z. And this transfer function Q of Z has its own numerator of Z, polynomial numerator, and polynomial denominator as a function of Z. I would say that as soon as we apply the decoupling filter, and I will show you very soon how to get this decoupling filter, when you apply the decoupling filter, the system is effectively decoupled, and our original process with the decoupling filter and the input will behave as two identical, absolutely independent systems with transfer function Q of Z equal to the determinant of the transfer matrix of the process. Now, this Q of Z most likely will have unacceptable dynamics. And because of this, our consequent task would be to introduce special feedback and special filter that would turn this transfer function into the closed-loop transfer function that would satisfy the design specifications. The next, what you can see is the definition of the decoupling filter W of Z. W of Z is represented by a 2x2 transfer matrix in my case. These are the diagonal elements, and it is defined as the adjoint of the transfer matrix of the controlled process. And it's a 2x2 transfer matrix, and you know how to take the adjoint. When you're taking a joint, the diagonal elements will exchange their positions. I will have G22 right here, and I will have G11 at this location. Now, the off-diagonal elements will not change their position, but they will change their sign. And therefore, you can easily relate this transfer matrix to this transfer matrix, and you would easily figure out what the particular components of the decoupling filter are. The next that we have to do, we have to inspect the Z domain transfer function Q of Z for the presence of bad zeros or Z domain zeros located outside the unit circle. And I will tell you, since Q of S had bad zeros, then most likely, with very high degree of certainty, Q of Z will also have bad zeros. Now, since we have these bad zeros, we're effectively dealing with a controlled plant that has transfer function with right-hand side zeros, and you understand that the Diophantine equation has to be used in this situation. In order to facilitate the Diophantine approach, what we have to do is to take the Z-domain transfer function that is equal to the determinant of the transfer matrix of the process, Z-domain transfer matrix of the process. And we have to represent it in this form. The denominator we will leave as a polynomial. The numerator with plus is the one that is responsible only for good zeros, and numerator plant with minus will be the one that is responsible for zeros outside the unit circle. And now, for certainty, for the purpose of our presentation, I will assume that the polynomial numerator of the plant with plus is the second order polynomial, and I will use betas for coefficients, and this betas will remind you, not b's but betas, this betas should remind you that we're dealing with the Z domain. The polynomial numerator plant with minus in the Z domain will have, it's also second order polynomial. I'm assuming it's a second order polynomial. So it has also betas for coefficients, but with minus, with a bar on the top. I guess this bar on the top should remind you that these are coefficients, or this is the polynomial that we call numerator polynomial with minus. And this is, I am assuming, it is a fifth order denominator of the plant, and it is defined in the Z domain, and I am using alphas for coefficients. Why it is fifth order? Well, I guess it's a kind of unpredictable, the order of this polynomial, because when you're taking the determinant of this transfer matrix, anything could happen. When you take this determinant, make sure that after you will get this transfer function, you attempt to reduce the order, because when you take the determinant, because of numerical noise, it is very likely that you would get not the normal order, but order that shall not be so high of an order. For example, you may get 15th order, but if you would subject this transfer function to simplification, to a procedure that is called near to approximation, you may end up getting a 7th order polynomials, 7th order transfer function. So please keep this in mind. One way or another, I have definition for polynomials involved in the transfer function of our controlled plant, quotes. It's not a controlled plant, you understand, but we will treat it as a controlled plant that has to be stabilized. The next, what we have to do, and this is a kind of difficult task, we have to look into design specifications, and we have to perform computer simulations in order to establish a S-domain model of the closed-loop system, of the desired closed-loop system. So the model with this transfer function supposed to have the required settling time, the allowable overshoot, the allowable undershoot. How we get this result? Unfortunately, the only what I can tell you about this model is that it has to include the polynomial numerator of the plant responsible for bad zeros. And I want you to note that I'm building this model in the S domain, because S domain is understood by engineers much better than Z domain. It's easy to work in S domain. So what we will do, we will establish this model in the S domain, and then when it will be established, we will be able to convert it into the Z domain and use for our design purposes. So the model supposed to have the necessary part: polynomial numerator plant with minus It comes from the previous steps. And then it will have terms like this, S plus P6, S plus P7, S plus P1, S plus P2, and so on. What is special about these terms? By successful choice of parameters P1, P2, P3, P4, P5, P6, P7, and the constant gain P0, we should be able to come up with a transfer function of the model that will satisfy design specs. Unfortunately, I cannot recommend you any formal procedure for doing so. What you would have to do is the following. If I would be doing this, I would start from building the transfer function that has this necessary term, and I would add maybe three terms where P1, P2, and P3 are poles chosen such that the settling time will be requirement will be satisfied. But then, when you will run simulation of the system with this numerator and this denominator, simulation, when you will apply a unit step and see the response, you will see very bad result. You will see the undershoot, you will see the overshoot, you will see completely different steady state value. Don't forget, steady state value should be equal to 1 because this transfer function represents the closed loop system. Now, you may introduce additional term to the denominator, and you may experiment with the value of P4 until you will get some improvement in the step response. And then you may add term S plus P6, and you may work with the experiment with values of P6 parameter until you will improve result further. And then you may end up adding S plus P5 term, and again you will be experimenting with P5, trying to improve the early obtained result, and so on. If you are lucky, if you have good imagination, you may not be able to use all this, you may not be obligated to use all these parameters, P1, P2, P3, up to P7. Okay? Now, if worst comes to worst, you will have to utilize all these 7 parameters, actually 8 parameters. What about this constant gain? The constant gain would allow you to scale the steady state value of the response, because the steady state value of the response should be equal to 1 if you're running experiments with unit step. So one way or another, this is supposed to be the part of your project that will require you to use intuition, patience, but so many generations of students successfully handle this difficulty. I have no doubts that you will be also successful. One way or another, when you're done, you have to represent the transfer function as the numerator of the plant with minus, this is this term. Everything the rest will be included in polynomial numerator of the model with asterisk, and the denominator has to be represented by a polynomial. And of course, don't waste your time. Use computer tools to do this type of computational efforts. So, as a result of step number 6, the transfer function of the model in the S domain will be established. And the step response of this model will satisfy design specs for the closed loop system. By the way, it's good to keep in mind that according to Diophantine rules, the difference between the order of the denominator of the model and order of the numerator of the model supposed to be equal or greater than the same difference for the controlled plant. So, if I would have a seventh order controlled plant or fifth order controlled plant, 1, 2, 3, 4, fifth order controlled plant, and fourth order of the numerator of this transfer function, I will be all right, because for transfer function Q of S or Q of Z, we have the same order, and for the polynomial numerator we have order of 4, and for the denominator we have order of 5. So I guess we're doing all right. Step number 7 is the conversion of the transfer function of the model, G model of S, into G model of Z, and you already recognize the symbol that I use, and when you will perform this conversion, you will have a polynomial denominator with z in the power of 5 and z in the power of 4 and so on. Now, for coefficients of this polynomial, I use mu 4, mu 3, mu 2, mu 1, and mu 0. And you will have the numerator. And the numerator will be split into polynomial numerator of the plant minus, but in the Z domain, and the rest. What is the rest? The rest, in my case, will be this product times this coefficient. So the rest I will package as this second order polynomial, sigma 2 times Z squared plus sigma 1 times Z plus sigma 0. And this part, this polynomial, I will call numerator of the model with asterisk. As I said, notations are self-explanatory. Our next move is to define polynomial A0. This polynomial, there is a special rule for choosing the order of polynomial A0, and I believe in my situation I could use order equal to 1 for polynomial A0, but if order of A0 is defined as greater than some value. So to be on the safe side, I chose A0 as a second order polynomial. How to define polynomial A0? You know, I'm trying to be as efficient and as lazy as I can. So I took this transfer function, 1 over a polynomial A0. Polynomial A0 I assume to be a second order polynomial. I made sure that roots of this polynomial are non-dominant with respect to the required system dynamics. And then I converted this transfer function into the Z domain with the required time step, and I got this result. But this question mark implies that I have absolutely no interest in the numerator of this transfer function. I'm interested only in the denominator. So my polynomial a0 of z will be later utilized in the design process. As I said, I chose a0 to be second order polynomial, and this is how I call it. This is my notation for this a0 in the z domain. So parameters are phi 1 and phi 0. This is my choice. Now we have to do step number 9, and it is time to recall the definition of the feedback controller according to the Diophantine design technique. The numerator of this controller is called numerator controller of z, and it is a polynomial. And I made order of this polynomial k. So it is a kth order polynomial. Keep in mind that z in the highest order has coefficient different from 1. It is not 1. It is some kind of value not equal to 1. The denominator of the controller consists of two terms. The first term is the polynomial numerator of the plant responsible for good zeros. This is the part of the polynomial numerator of the plant with good zeros that carries these good zeros. And this is just a polynomial. Order of this polynomial, we call it controller with asterisk, we call it, following the lecture materials and following the way the Diophantine equation technique is presented in most textbooks. So listen, this is a polynomial. I made order of this polynomial L. I want you to note that z in the highest order in this polynomial has coefficient equal to 1. It is important. Z in the highest order in the numerator has coefficient different from 1, but z in the highest order in the denominator, in the polynomial denominator controller asterisk, must have coefficient equal to 1. Where are these things coming from? Well, Diophantine equation technique is basically an algebraic approach, and we're trying to handle the situation that enables us to find some unknown parameters, unknown coefficients of several polynomials. One way or another, what you can see here is the Diophantine equation itself. In this Diophantine equation, first of all, I have the polynomial denominator of the plant, in the z domain, of course. Then this is the polynomial denominator of the controller with asterisk. This is this polynomial. Then I have, and now I have to fix it. Those terms supposed to be z's, not s's. Okay, it is fixed. So look, this is the polynomial from the numerator of the controlled plant, polynomial responsible for bad zeros. And the next you can see the polynomial from the numerator of the controller. So this sum is the left-hand side of the Diophantine equation. And the right-hand side of the Diophantine equation, I have the denominator of the model times polynomial a0. And again, let me fix here, this is supposed to be z, not s. Z and z. Sorry about this. Nobody is perfect. All right. In the right-hand side, I have this product. What I am doing next, I am trying to rewrite the Diophantine equation with more detail, basically. So look, I wrote very explicitly the denominator of the controlled plant. This is the polynomial denominator of the controller with asterisk, this one, plus this is the polynomial of the controlled plant responsible for bad zeros. This is the polynomial numerator of the controller, this one. I got the left-hand side of the Diophantine equation. In the right-hand side, I have the polynomial denominator of the model times polynomial a0, as I defined it earlier. Now I want you to realize that I want to multiply this polynomial by this polynomial. They both are defined numerically. And I'm getting seventh order polynomial in the right-hand side. So look what happened. This is the polynomial of the plant. This is the polynomial denominator of the controller with asterisk. This is the polynomial of the plant numerator that carries bad zeros. This is the numerator of the controller polynomial. And in the right hand side, I have seventh order polynomial. Where it came from? From multiplication of this polynomial by this polynomial. How to perform this type of multiplications? Of course, using computer tool. Find a way how to use computer tools. Otherwise, your entire time will be consumed by doing things that people do in the ninth grade of the high school, you know. Use computer tools. And now if I will take a very, very close look, and if I would think a little bit about the Diophantine equation as it is written here, I should conclude, and you should agree with me, that this polynomial, look, this polynomial, should be a second order polynomial. Why? Because I'm supposed to have z in the power of 7 in the left hand side, and I have z in the power of 7 in the right hand side. So if this is a second order polynomial, no further questions. And being a second order polynomial, and I wrote it right here, it has two unknown coefficients, only two unknown coefficients, theta 1 and theta 0, that have to be determined. How we determine them? Well, from a very straightforward requirement, left-hand side of the Diophantine equation must be equal to the right-hand side. Now, how about the order of polynomial numerator of the controller. This one. I'm saying it has to be fourth order. Why? Because the Diophantine equation, according to its right-hand side, is suitable for finding the total of 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 parameters. So, two parameters will be theta 1 and theta 0, and I still can define 5 more parameters. So, if I would make this polynomial fourth order, and don't forget, I emphasize that z in the highest order is supposed to have coefficient different from 1. So if it's a fourth order polynomial, then number of unknown coefficients will be 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. So the Diophantine equation now is capable of producing for us total of 7 coefficients. And the 7 coefficients, as soon as we will compute these coefficients, they will define this polynomial, and they will define this polynomial, and I will be able to define the feedback controller. Design step number 10 implies that we're building this matrices that I recommend to build in my textbook. You know, there are certain rules for filling these matrices, and let me go over these rules with you. First of all, what you can see here, first of all, the matrices are intended for finding the total of 7 unknown coefficients, and therefore, this matrix is 7 by 1, this is 7 by 7, 7 by 1, and 7 by 1. Now, how to fill this column? This column is filled by the coefficients of the right-hand side polynomial of the Diophantine equation. You know, in the right-hand side of the Diophantine equation, we have polynomial of the model denominator multiplied by polynomial a0. So this is a seventh order polynomial in my case, and here you have all coefficients listed starting from omega 6, omega 5. So obviously I'm not using coefficient equal to 1 for the highest order of z. So you can clearly see where this terms came from. The next, what I do, I have to list in the first column all coefficients of the polynomial denominator of the controlled plant. The first coefficient is 1, the second coefficient is alpha 4, alpha 3, alpha 2, alpha 1, alpha 0. I run out of coefficients, I'm putting 0. The next column, I will start from 1, and then I will again list all coefficients of the polynomial denominator of the controlled plant. Now, I reach the bottom of the table. This last coefficient, a0, is on the bottom. This means that I am done with the coefficients of the polynomial denominator of the controlled plant. What I am doing next is this. There is some controversy about this, but let me tell you the following. You probably will be better off filling the rest of the columns starting from the right side. Look, this is the first coefficient of the polynomial numerator plant with minus. Okay? This is this polynomial. The first coefficient is 1. the next coefficient is beta 1 bar, beta 0 bar. The next one, column, I start from 1, but I moved by one step up. And then I have beta 1 bar, beta 0 bar, and 0. And this is how I move from the right side to the left side. It is a little bit different from what my textbook tells you, but when you will get down to filling this matrix, I don't think you would have too many choices. The next column contains all unknowns. The unknowns being coefficients of the two polynomials that have to be determined. They are unknowns. What about this one? Here we have coefficients of the polynomial denominator of the plant. But I start from alpha 4, alpha 3, alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha 1, and alpha 0, the rest are zeros. Look, it's basically the same column, but I started from alpha 4. I'm not using this 1. There is no room for 1. Now, this is my recommendation on how to build the matrix equation that would give you values of unknown coefficients of the polynomials. At the same time, if you have interest, try to work with the Diophantine equation procedure that is available in MATLAB. But then you have to understand how it works, and it will be best if you would predefine orders of polynomial this one and order of this polynomial, because the procedure could be quite confusing. However, if these orders are defined, the procedure will be more practical to use. One way or another, you know how to find unknown coefficients from this equation. These are numbers. These are numbers. These are numbers. You know how to find unknown coefficients from this equation. And when you will find these unknown coefficients, you will be able to define the feedback controller. In the numerator, you have polynomial delta 4z4 plus delta 3z cubed and so on. In the denominator, you have the polynomial numerator of the control plant with plus. I mean the one responsible for good zeros. And then you have this polynomial, this one, that you will get out of the Diophantine equation. So this is how you will get the feedback controller. What's next? The next, you should be able to define the filter. And there is a very well-defined rule for the filter in the reference channel. The filter in the reference channel has the same denominator as the feedback controller. This is denominator, this is denominator. Now, in the numerator, you will have polynomial a0 multiplied by the polynomial that I call numerator model asterisk. When this is done, your design technique is complete, and what you have to do would be to implement your design in computer simulation. But please keep in mind, your original controlled plant was defined as a continuous controlled plant, so when you simulate, you have to build a simulation block that is a continuous time simulation transfer function block. All right? And then you would be able to add the special Z domain or discrete time components to the system. However, your simulation shall not be that primitive. Don't forget that your simulation will start from the very beginning, and I will watch for this. You will start your simulation from implementing in software this transfer matrix, S domain transfer matrix. And then in the input of this transfer matrix, you will insert decoupling filter. And this decoupling filter already will be discrete time decoupling filter. Okay? And then you will proceed with the feedback controller and the filter in the reference channel. And obviously they will be applied to the structure built from the original transfer matrix of the plant and the transfer matrix of this decoupling filter. So good luck in doing this type of project. The next that I want to do with you, and I guess it will be the last topic for our semester, we will discuss the design of a discrete time decoupling control system using the linear model following approach. Problem starts from the definition of the continuous time control plant. And it's a matrix vector definition of the plant. And I want you to keep in mind that I chose the fourth order controlled plant, but the transfer matrix, matrix B through which we apply control efforts to this plant is a 4x4 matrix, which means that there are total of four control efforts in this system. Matrix B, when we do linear model following technique, implementing linear model following technique, this matrix B of the plant will be inverted more than once, and therefore it better be a square matrix. And I have to tell you, you heard about pseudo-inverse, but pseudo-inverse in our linear model following design problem is not suitable. It will give you some really serious numerical problems. Now, our plant is a second order, plant with two outputs, four inputs according to the configuration of matrix B, fourth order according to the dynamics of the system, but it has two outputs. And now you may ask me why I have such a simple definition of the outputs. You know, our system uses state variable number 1 and state variable number 3 as the outputs. Why? Because it's a very realistic situation. Because this could be voltage, this could be acceleration, and there are some other outputs, but they are not considered. There are some other state variables, but they are not considered to be outputs. Matrix C is used to designate particular signals as the outputs of the system. What if this matrix would be filled with numbers? This would imply that the output number 1, for example, is equal to velocity times some coefficient plus altitude times some coefficient plus current times some coefficient. You know, it would be something bogus because the assumption is that this matrix vector definition deals with real physical variables. and therefore outputs should be real physical variables. If he would get into the CCAF situation or some other artificially created configurations, then state variables could be fictitious. Then we would be seeing output that is a combination of voltage and acceleration, of voltage and altitude, but not in the case when we're dealing with real physical variables. The next, you're supposed to see the design specs. We will do the decoupling. Our goal is to turn our system into a system with two inputs and two outputs, completely decoupled system, and the individual channels of the system supposed to have particular settling time, particular overshoot, and we also have to take into account that there is certain time step of the discrete time controller delta T. Our design step number one is to convert continuous time description of the controlled plant, of the controlled process, into the discrete time description. You know how to do it using a series. However, if you are interested in good accuracy, then the number of terms in a series should be equal to 20. Obviously, you need a computer for this purpose. So, of course, use a computer tool to perform this transformation. And when this transformation will be complete, you will get matrix A, but for discrete time situation, matrix B for discrete time description. However, matrix C not supposed to change, it will stay the same. Our step number two deals with the following reality of life. There is a very good chance that this fundamental matrix, or if you prefer, this fundamental matrix has bad eigenvalues. Bad in the sense of instability of the appropriate system. Okay? And besides, eigenvalues could be unacceptable for some reasons, one way or another. Our first move would be to make sure that the fundamental matrix of our system, this time it would be closed-loop system, will have the desired eigenvalues. And I would choose this desired eigenvalues in the S domain. Since it's a fourth-order system, we can expect to have four eigenvalues. How I would choose them? I would choose them to feel confident about system operation, about the convergence of the controlled loop, controlled process. I would use some kind of eigenvalues that you and I would feel comfortable. And of course, they should be located in the left-hand side of the S-plane. And then based on this eigenvalues, lambda 1, lambda 2, lambda 3, and lambda 4, I will define a transfer function, S domain transfer function, where these eigenvalues will serve as poles. When this is done, I will convert this transfer function into the Z domain. And you can see I will use zero order hold option and the required time step. Now, this is the result of this conversion. And let me tell you that the numerator is irrelevant for our further analysis. But the denominator is important because on the basis of this denominator, I will create the desired closed loop fundamental matrix, or fundamental matrix of the desired closed loop system. So, how I got this result? By inspection, of course, by inspection, like when we do the direct decomposition. When this closed loop fundamental matrix is defined, I am ready to perform step number 3. You know, let me fix this. Okay, now it is fixed. You will see this text of the lecture posted in my courses. But you remember, or you must remember, that when we do linear model following approach, when we implement linear model following approach, there is a special equation that we have to satisfy. And this equation basically says that the A closed loop, fundamental matrix of the closed loop system, should be equal to the fundamental matrix of the control plant minus matrix B of the control plant times matrix Kp. Matrix Kp is nothing but a local state variable feedback that will be used to modify properties of the control, dynamics of the control plant. And from this equation, you should be able to define matrix Kp like this. Now, you should realize that matrix B discrete for the control plant shall not be singular. And if it is non-singular, then I guess solution is available. And solution should look like a square matrix, in my case 4x4, and matrix Kp, as I said, will be implemented as a state variable feedback to form the state variable feedback that would change properties of the control plant. You know, it makes a lot of sense when you will define this matrix to check if indeed this equality holds. If indeed A discrete of the plant minus B discrete of the plant times Kp will be equal to A closed loop. And it will be equal to, believe me, if you did everything right. Our next step, number 4, is that we have to familiarize ourselves with the design specs, specifically settling time overshoot and required for individual channels of the decoupled system. And then we should be able to come up with S-domain transfer functions that will be consistent with this design specifications. And I have these two transfer functions, Q1 and Q2. These transfer functions are to be converted into the Z domain, and you have my symbolism here for this conversion, and I'm using Greek letters for parameters of this converted transfer functions. Here they are. And then, when this is done, I want to build the model of the desired decoupled two-input, two-output system. Look, with this configuration of the fundamental matrix, and with this configuration of the matrix B, and you also remember what matrix C looks like, surely, surely, this matrix vector description represents two second-order, absolutely independent dynamic systems. And of course, for each of these dynamic systems, the design specs would be, the systems will be consistent with the design specs. The next that you have to do is to solve the next equation. There are two more equations in the linear model following design. One equation will result in matrix Km, and another equation will result in matrix Ku. And I guess you have to solve these equations. Solution of both equations requires that matrix B of the plant be non-singular. And I have to tell you that letter G is missing here. Now this looks good, and I have to put letter G. Here, and letter G here. Because we're solving these equations utilizing state variable description for the discrete time domain. One way or another, solving these equations is possible if matrix B discrete of the plant is non-singular, and I guess we're getting the result. If we would assemble our system will be indeed a fully decoupled system consisting of two fully independent second-order systems. I want to emphasize that it is very important that matrix B of the controlled plant be square, in other words, the number of control efforts be equal to the number of state variables to the order of the system. At this point, the main challenge is to implement continuous time controlled plant as it was defined by a matrix vector definition, and implement individual matrices obtained for discrete time domain, test your system in computer simulation setup.